Please welcome the Gospel Lighthouse Church Virtual Choir with special guest, Dr. Jerry D. Fryar.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. We just come to worship Him and adore our Lord. But there's no one like You, Jesus. No one can do what our Savior has done. He is great and mighty. He is holy. And we adore Your name, Father. Come on, church.
Come let us adore Him. Kneel down before Him. Worship and adore Him. Come let us adore Him. Kneel down before Him. Worship and adore Him.
Emmanuel. Emmanuel. He's King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
We worship you.
He's the mighty Jehovah.
We worship you.
He's a Redeemer, a Deliverer.
We worship you.
He's our refuge and hope.
We worship you.
He's Emmanuel, God with us.
We worship you.
He's a soon coming King.
We worship you.
He's our future and our present.
We worship you.
He's an awesome God.
We worship you.
Well, praise God. What a wonderful, beautiful song and appropriate song, Emmanuel, God with us. And I'll tell you, the fact that he came and he's here, glory to God. It makes all the difference in the world. When he's here or he's there, you know, one of the names of God, Jehovah Shammah, means he's present. And you find it in the book of Ezekiel, at the end of Ezekiel, it simply emphasizes that God will always be present. And Emmanuel, God with us. I'll tell you, Christmas is a phenomenal thing. It always blows my mind for the magnitude of God being who he is, and yet God would become a man, take on humanity, so that he could be with us and dwell among us, and we beheld his glory. Well, praise God. Obviously, Christmas has the particular day, 25th, has gone by, and this is post-Christmas, but the season is always right to worship and adore him. I'm going to be bringing a scripture in a few moments to you, but it's almost like the Magi in Matthew chapter 2. We're going to be reading from Matthew chapter 1 in a few moments. But the Magi, what we call the wise men that came probably from Baghdad and that area, you know, the statement they made was, "Where is he that is born King of the Jews? Therefore, we have seen his star." Now, it's amazing that God would specify and just have something particularly in the atmosphere, in the heavens, that would be designated. And they knew it was the star. They knew it was the indication of a king being born. They said King of the Jews. Of course, you know that Herod had a problem with that. But the other amazing thing is, you go on down in Matthew chapter 2, it talks about how that when they came and when they finally found Jesus, it's an amazing statement that's made that really will probably blow the scientist's mind and the astronomer's mind. It says that as they were looking, going through, they probably, you know, at least there were, I'm sure there was over 30 or 40 or 50 homes there. And it states that when they came, the way they knew the house that he was in at that time is the fact that a star, it says the star stood still over the house where he was. Now, really, if a star would come that close in our time, it would disintegrate our home. But it's something, it was something supernatural. That wasn't just a natural phenomenon going on. That was really a miraculous supernatural. And, of course, the whole birth of Jesus, the whole Christmas event is miraculous in itself. And I want to read Matthew chapter 1, and I'm reading from the New King James Translation. And I'm going to begin reading at verse number 18. And it says, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother, Mary, was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she shall bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, 'Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel,' which is translated God, hallelujah, with us. And then Joseph, being aroused from his sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took her to be his wife. and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. And it's amazing. I mean, it's just totally, there's some specifics about the whole Christmas event here about Jesus, alluding earlier about the Magi, how they were seeking him to worship him, to adore him. They knew that he was a person of status that need to be worshiped. And that's why they was looking for him, to worship him. And when they found him, they did worship him and offered him gifts. And so there are several things, specific things that's in the particular text that we read that really bring about the fact that Jesus should be worshiped, that he deserves every right to be worshiped. There are three particular things that we want to highlight. Why should he be adored? Why should he be worshiped? Why should he be so admired and honored? Why should our hearts melt and we just want to bow and honor him and exalt him? There are three reasons here. Well, first of all, we need to understand that Jesus, when we in the Hebrew, is Yeshua. Now, we have to transliterate that. What I mean by transliterating is that when you have when you are bringing from one language to another language, and you don't have everything identical, what you have to do is choose letters that will sort of match what's going on in the other language. So when we transliterate, compare and bring over, ascribe to the English language from the Hebrew language, when we get basically transliterating of Jesus' name, we come out with Yeshua. And Yeshua simply means that Yahweh, glory to God, that Yahweh saves. That Yahweh saves. So this is what was being told, that his name shall be called Jesus, Yeshua. And it simply means that Yahweh saved. Now, Yahweh is God's covenant name. Sometimes we say Jehovah in our English vernacular. And Jehovah is twofold. It means that it's, first of all, it means self-existence. And it also means self-revealing. So when you say Jehovah God or Yahweh, you're talking about a supernatural God, a being that you couldn't just guess up on him. There are certain things that he put out in the atmosphere or in creation that gives us some insight. But the real insight and depth is that God has to intentionally self-reveal and allow us to understand that he's self-existing, that he needs nobody or anything to be who he is. He is God, all right? God created, but nobody created God. God is always, he's eternal. And so here we have a God coming in humanity through the virgin birth, and Jesus says. So when we expand that, what we begin to understand is that we need to, first of all, we need to worship him for the first reason, is for who he is. He is Yeshua, which means Savior, praise God. We worship him because he is the Savior. And that's what the angel mentioned to the shepherds that we mentioned last week, message in Luke chapter 2, when it talks about how the angels were out in the field and they were tending their sheep, the flock by night, and an angel all of a sudden appeared and made an announcement to them. He told them that, hey, you know, born this day in the city of Judah, in Bethlehem of Judea, is a Savior, Christ the Lord. So it's always been emphasis on the fact that Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, is Savior. So we worship him because he is the Savior, God in flesh. John chapter 1. Verse 14 says, and the Word, which when verse 1, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. In other words, God took on humanity. God came into our neighborhood. God came into our being. God took on the kind of form that we had. God took on humanity, not just a look like it. God literally in his nature became God-man. Yes, so the Son of God is God taking on flesh. And that's why Emmanuel transliterated and God with us. And so when he came, it is God with us. So we worship him for who he is. And who is he? He is Yeshua. Glory to God. He is Jehovah that saves. But we also worship him for the why. Why did he come? Why did he come? And it tells us here in Matthew chapter 21, why he came. It says, and you shall bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, Yeshua, Joshua saith, for he will save his people from their sins.
Now, he's very specific about why he came. The reason he came is to save people from their sins. All right, save people from their sins. That was the problem. A lot of people say, well, what is sin? A sin is not just breaking a law or rule. Sin goes back to the root. Sin entered into the world because there was a disruption in relationship. So all sin has to do with relationship. The first sin that entered into humanity was when our first parents, Adam and Eve, when they broke, they violated relationship. They violated what the covenant with God. They violated their loyalty to God, and that's how sin came into the world. So whenever there's sin in any form, it is a violation of a relationship in some format. So what is it the angel saying here? He's saying that he will save his people from their sins. And then in Matthew chapter 4, it talks about not only the Jewish people, but it talks about the nations. It makes that prophetic statement of how that the land of Zebulun and Zadah, how that a light has shined and a light has come. And so he came to save his people, save people from their sin, save people from the broken relationship they had with God, save people from just a broken relationship they'd inherited from their parents, and save people from this broken and disloyalty to living. Now, I think a lot of times we misrepresent Jesus Christ. We've misrepresented him on why he came. We tell people a lot of time that come on to Jesus, just give your life to Jesus, and everything's going to be all right. You'll be delivered from everything. But God didn't say that. God didn't tell them in this part. The angel did not say that he will save you from your enemies. At this point in time, when Jesus was born, the Romans was over the Jewish people. They were viewed as enemies to the Jews. God did not say, I've come to at this point in time to save you from the Romans. He didn't save them from their enemy. He says, Jesus came to save people from their sins. And I think we need to give people the proper message. We've given them the wrong message. We misrepresent Jesus. We're telling them that Jesus came to do something that he didn't say he came to do. He came, first of all, to deliver people from their sin so that broken relationship could be put back. The main relationship is the broken relationship that we have with God. We are born in spiritual darkness. We don't have a connection with God. So Jesus came to be an offering, a sacrifice, ultimately, to save people from their sin. And of course, today, when you give your life to Jesus Christ, there's no guarantee that the enemies you've had in life all of a sudden are going to become your friend. The only guarantee you have from the Lord is that when you give Jesus Christ your life, you will be saved from the broken relationship that you've had with God, that spiritual death and darkness. And you may have a whole lot of things may still go on in the world. And a lot of things may not be right in the world at this time. But there's coming a time when God will make everything right. But the first and primary thing that Jesus Christ wants to do in our life is to save us or deliver us from the broken relationship that we have with God. So if your life is not, if you've not surrendered your life to God, you still are living in a broken relationship. And if you die in that broken relationship, you're going to be eternally lost. So Jesus came in the flesh, Emmanuel with us, so he could die for us to mend the broken relationship. And that's why the Bible says in 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, he said, if you confess your sin, acknowledge you've done wrong, and you'll be forgiven. And it says the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. What is the whole purpose? It's always been God's ultimate purpose and beginning. God knew before anything else can go on, I need to deliver people from the sin problem that they have, from the things they have going on in their lives that break up relationship. So we worship him because he, first of all, for who he is, he's Yeshua, he's Yahweh that saves, he's Yahweh that delivers. And then we worship him for why he came. And he came to save us from our sins. Praise God. So they would not be eternally lost. And the third reason we worship him is we worship him for what it means to confess his name. Now, we've already said that the Jesus means Yeshua. And Yeshua is really means Yahweh saves. And the reason he came is to save us from our sins. And so we worship him for what it means to confess his name. So if you put this together, if you put Jesus saved, Yahweh delivers, that the reason he came was that Jesus came, Yahweh came in the flesh to save us and deliver us from the broken relationship, from the spiritual bondage, that broken relationship with God. And then we confess his name. So do you understand? Every time you confess the name of Jesus Christ, what you are confessing is, you're confessing to him, I recognize and I acknowledge that you were God in the flesh. I recognize that you came and that you are a Savior. You are my Savior. You are the only Savior. And you recognize that there's no one that can save but Jesus. So when you confess his name, that's why Peter said in the book of Acts, when he was preaching, says that there is no name under heaven whereby men shall be, except what? By the name of Jesus, by the name of Yeshua, by the name of Yahweh saves, by the name that Yahweh delivers. So when you confess the name of Jesus, you ought to worship him. When you confess his name, when you say, Jesus, you are Lord, what you are telling him, Jesus, you are God in the flesh. You are my Savior. You are my deliverer. You are the person that came and sacrificed your life. And you gave your life so that I could be in right relationship, so that I could spend eternity in right relationship with you, that I could be delivered from the bondage that I was born in because of the inheritance that I got from my first parents. That's why we worship him. Hallelujah. So when you confess, and that's what Paul, when he was writing to the Philippians in Philippians chapter 2 and verse number 9, Paul makes this statement. He says, for God has highly exalted him. Highly exalted him, nobody else. And it says that God has given him a name. Well, we know here in the text with Matthew, it was the angel, it was God that instructed to the angel of the Lord on who, what to name him. Name him Jesus, Yeshua, Yeshua, Yahweh saves. He will be called Emmanuel, God with us. So when Paul says in Philippians, he says that God gave him this name. God gave him this name. God gave him, and it says, at the name of Jesus, at the name of Yahweh saves, at the name of Yeshua, the deliverer, at the name of Jesus, the saving one from our sins, at his name, every knee shall bow. And every tongue will confess, hallelujah, hallelujah, that Jesus, glory to God, that Jesus is Lord. The word Lord means Kyrios. It means the high supreme one. Jesus is Lord. And it says that you, when you do this, this is to the glory of God. Jesus is who he is, begotten the glory of God. Jesus the in the flesh, God in the flesh. Jesus that died on the cross. Jesus that was raised again from the dead. Jesus that comes into your life when you repent. Jesus that's going to come back someday and receive all of us unto himself. Whether you're dead in the grave, you'll be raised. And that his name is to God be the glory. And we mentioned last week that glory means the splendor and attributes of God, the magnificence of God. When you talk about the glory of God, you're talking about the brilliance of God. I mean, that which exceeds and goes beyond any human effort. So Jesus is highly exalted. And the reason he came, hallelujah, and the reason he came, and the reason he came, glory to God, is to, first of all, demonstrate God being with us, God coming and dwelling amongst us. But he came to save us from our sins. So please tell people that when people say, well, I gave my heart to the Lord and this is happening and that's happening, tell them that the guarantee that God gave you was to save you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. From your sin. Do you know you can die and spend eternity with God having certain enemies and all that, but you can't die and spend eternity with God if you don't get the sin problem settled. So we worship him because Jesus is the answer. And as I said last week, no, we're not arguing about the date and all this and that. What we want to go after, what is the message? The message is that God so loved us that he came into our midst, that he wrapped himself up in humanity, that he died on the cross, and he raised again to save us from our sins. And that's why Jesus came. That's the only reason he came, was to save us from our sins. And he's the only one that can save us from our sins. And praise God. We'll thank God. We want to be saved from our sins. Praise God. So we confess him today as our Lord and as our Savior. And we simply say, Jesus, we are so thankful that you came. Praise your name. And we're so thankful that we've been able to experience you as Emmanuel. Hallelujah. And a little young girl, I love to hear her sing, and you probably hear her sing, is that happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad that you came. I'm so glad you came. I am so glad you came. I'm so glad you came. I'll never be able to express the gratitude and the thanksgiving for you, for the reason that you came. Hallelujah. I'm glad that you came, because I know the main reason you came was to deliver me from the bondage of sin, that which kept me separated from being in a right relationship with my Heavenly Father. Thank you that you came and you settled that issue. And I know now, though I walk with you in my heart and you that know him in your heart, but just think, if you know Jesus, you've given Jesus your life, you don't have to be, there's never going to be a time from this point forward that you're going to be out of the eternal realm of God. If you die, I mean, you may die here. You may die with some enemy around. You may die from some in some war, but it doesn't make any difference. If you receive Jesus, if you receive Yeshua, glory, everything is going to be all right, okay? So let's make the thing, let's make the main thing the main thing. Quit worrying about little this and little that. The main thing that God is after when he came into this world was to save us from our sins. And Jesus did that greatly on the cross. And he's saving us to this day. Praise God. He's still saving. Even us that's been born again, he's still saving us daily. He's saving us more, getting our minds more developed. He's saving us more from ignorance and understanding him in a greater way. And I'd just like to tell you, it's time to worship him for who he is and for why he came and what it means to confess his name. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you're looking today or listening today and you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, you've missed the primary reason. We can celebrate Christmas. See, a lot of times people go through the motion of Christmas, but you can go through the motion and miss the person. We can go through the motion. We can talk about the lights. We can talk about this. We can talk about that. But got to watch going through the motion and miss the message, and miss the person, and that's Jesus Christ. So if you've never given him your life, this will be a good time. Just simply open up your heart and say, Lord, I thank you that you came. I thank you that you loved us enough to come into our world and take on humanity, die on a cross, be raised again from the dead. I can't save myself. If I could save myself, you would have had no reason to come. If I could save myself, I can't. So, Lord, I receive Jesus as my Savior and my Lord. I want to be right relationship with you. I thank you for this day. If you prayed that prayer, then welcome to the family of God. And there are going to be some statements made at the end of this broadcast that will allow you to get in touch with us, and we'll be able to help you grow further. Until next time, God bless you.
Tinsels and lights and the presents are nice, but the real gift is you. Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so glad it's Christmas. All the carols and bells make the holiday swell, and it's all about you. Happy birthday, Jesus, I love you. Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm so
If you wish to contribute to the ministry, you may do so safely and securely at our website, www.glhc1.org, and follow the online giving link. Mobile giving at Cash App, $GLHCVision, or by mail, Gospel Lighthouse Church, 600 Freebus Avenue, Columbus, Ohio, 43206.
Scan the barcode on your smartphone and it will take you directly to the online giving link at Gospel Lighthouse Church.